6.
Right. So I got a good run on him and didn't use the brakes going in.
He slowed me down. I made the corner.
I came back around and the Nissan was up the sidewall.
Did I not make that?
No.
I remember it different.
You didn't make it.
And you remember that? That was raining so hard.
That was 80.
That was 86.
That's 56. Well, you two are buddies, really. A long time.
Oh, man. He's tried to kill me.
He's tried to kill me a few times.
We've had a lot of fun.
We met through a mutual friend, Paul Newman. We all shared a love for speed. I always wanted to make a film about NASCAR, and after spending time with Rick, I came up with the idea for a film that later became Days of Thunder. During the filming of Days of Thunder, Rick invited me to stay at his family lake house in Charlotte, and to this day, they have always made me feel like family. The Hendrick Motorsports story isn't just about trophies or titles. It is about family. It is about friendship. Rick's story, and the story of his team, is about having the will to win and the strength to endure. It's about staying together. The Hendrick Motorsports story began near the small town of South Hill, Virginia. Life moves a little more slowly here. Hard work is valued. Rick and his younger brother John learned that from an early age. Their dad, Papa Joe, as we called him, was a World War II veteran who became a tobacco farmer. He raised his boys to appreciate family and togetherness.
My dad and all the other farmers worked really close together, and if someone had a problem, everybody pitched in. If your tractor was down and you needed to borrow a tractor and finish plowing field, that working together and sharing, you know, your assets, I learned at a very early age. My dad loved to race, and I was a gearhead, and I would want to do what he was doing. And he taught me how to work on equipment, and he taught me how to work on the race cars, and he took me to the races.
Well, Pop said he knew that Rick wasn't going to be a farmer. He said one day he left him something to do on the farm. When he come back, he said Rick could hire somebody to do it.
I didn't know what I wanted to be when I grew up, but I knew what I didn't want to be, and that was farming.
But you always loved cars, Rick.
Oh, I always had a passion for cars.
He was a natural mechanic, and he knew what he was talking about. I could show him something one time. He had it. I did have to get after him a little bit because he was quite a speed demon. He had a lead foot. He liked speed.
Yeah, he bought his 31 Chevrolet before he had a driver's license, and they started modifying it for a street rod.
I remember the day you came home with that piece of junk, and you wanted me to come out there and see your car. And I went out there, and I said, Rick, did you pay $200 for this? And you were so proud. You started drag racing, which I thought was fine, and you won quite a bit in that.
What we did on our dates was work on the cars that he had to, fix up and sell to help make some extra money. When I met him, he actually had 5 roommates, and they rented this old house, a very old house. It was $100 a month.
Rick had a date and was going out, and we didn't have any water, so we borrowed the garden hose from the neighbor and held it in the bathtub and paid the guy's shower. So we made things work.
I had to loan him money to help pay his rent sometimes, but he was in school and paying his way through school. He made the comment he felt like he'd known me my whole life. Of course, I didn't know if that was a familiar line that he used always or not. I didn't know him that well, but we got married a year after we dated, 13 months actually, January 1973.
She's been right there from the very beginning. You know, I was going to school and she would detail a car. I bought and sold Corvettes and some had body damage, and I would fix them and then turn around and sell them. I figured out then that there was a little bit more money selling them than it was working on them.
He started the used car dealership, and they'd never had a dealer that young and really inexperienced. Rick was feeling a lot of responsibility with having a family because we had a baby at that time, which our daughter Lynn was an infant, and he didn't want to make a wrong move. He generally cared about people, and I knew that he would be good to people.
Hello there. How you doing? Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. What you up to? I check her credit. I don't know if her credit's any good. Congratulations on an outstanding weekend. How many did you get?
64.
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
We start on Thursday.
Thursday, okay. Well, that's good. I think you can be successful in life without walking on or over people. And I generally like people. I think my biggest asset is being able to get along with people.
Hi, darling.
Show them the lady that really runs this
place. Hey, how y'all doing?
She runs the whole
organization.
I think you treat people with respect. You get it back. I think your reputation is really all you have. Your reputation is the only thing you've got in this life. You know, your assets will come and go. But if you have a reputation of treating people fairly, people have faith in you. That's the only thing we got in this life that we can hold on to.
Well, thank you a lot.
Rick's approach was straightforward. To him, people were the bottom line. And that's how he became one of the top auto dealers in the United States. As his business grew, Rick was able to pursue two more passions, his love for speed and his love for the water.
Started racing boats and went from, just playing on the lake to running drag boats. Got my first taste of professional racing in a championship with the boats. We won championships 3 years in a row, I think 78, 79, 80.
We held several world championships and several world records. They call it top fuel hydro, 222 miles an hour and a quarter.
You were racing a boat with no protection, which was twice more dangerous than a car.
After teammate and friend Jimmy Wright was killed on the water, Rick retired from boats, but not racing. He stored his equipment in the shop of a former NASCAR crew chief, Harry Hyde.
Harry got a bad rap for some reason, and he told me one day, he said, if somebody would give me a chance, I could go out there and win a race today if I built a car. And I started trying to find sponsorship.
I went over to see him, but thinking, well, car dealer, he'll be naive, you know, he'll want to do it on what we used to call OPM, other people's money. Nobody wanted to invest their own money in these teams. And then he just really jolted me by saying, I know nobody knows who I am, but I will invest in starting a team.
You seem to be the kind of person that likes a challenge.
I really do. Yeah, nothing motivates me any more than someone telling me I can't do it.
Frankly, I'd never heard anybody say they would put their own money up first. Maybe this guy, he'll pay dues, he'll invest to get in.
Rick received help from Robert G., who knew Rick as a teenager.
Robert ran a Flying A station on the corner in South Hill, and he had a little body shop. And I went to see him one day and asked him about putting a scoop on the hood of my Chevelle, and he did it. And did a really nice job, and so that's how I met Robert. He was building a Busch car, said, hey, would you like to be a partner with me in this car?
The driver of the car was Robert G.'s son-in-law, Dale Earnhardt. In his first race as an owner, Rick won. But working with Earnhardt was a one-race deal. In 1984, his new team was supposed to star Richard Petty as its driver and country music star Kenny Rogers as a co-owner, and that's why it was named All-Star Racing. But then both stars backed out.
With some of the financial pieces he'd put in there at the beginning didn't materialize as he had planned, and he's going like, I think I bit off more than I can chew. And he said, but I'm going to carry through with it, and we're going to just have to see how we can get through it. He would take care of people. That was his philosophy.
It's all about people. It's not about the brand. It's not about, you know, what kind of car you race or run or sell.
The fact that the people that were available at the time that came together so quick, we had a bunch of unknown soldiers, and I remember some people calling us F-Troop.
We had this conversation, and he said, you know, I don't have a sponsor. You know, this would be all out of my pocket, but I want to start this team, and so I can't really guarantee that we're going to race the whole season.
And there was only 5 guys that worked in our shop. We'd have a meeting back then. There wasn't but something like 12 to 15, including the engine shop.
I mentioned that Jeff would be driving the late model sports and target field.
Yeah. You'll go over to Robert G's. I'm the car with Robert Earnhardt drove last year, and we
we built a new car, a Super Speedway car for Daytona this year.
In the eighth race of the season, the team arrived at Martinsville without a sponsor. They needed to win, soon, or the dream would be over.
With 48 laps to go, Jeff Bodine settled the battle when he clawed his way past Walter Van Allison to grab the lead. From that point, Bodine never gave ground as he chalked up his very first Winston Cup victory 4.5 seconds ahead of the pack.
Now, Rick wasn't even in victory lane that day. He was in church with his family.
And you called and you said, Mama, who won the race? And I said, Rick, you don't know. You said, no. And I said, he blew. You said, oh, no. And I said, he won.
Why'd you tell me he blew up?
Joking with you.
Well, I kind of had a weak feeling in my knees because we didn't know we were going to get the race much longer if we didn't get a sponsor.
Jimmy Johnson became the team's first general manager. He secured new sponsors and helped keep the organization going through the early years. The team won 3 races in 1984. By 1986, they were aiming even higher. But to win the Daytona 500, they'd have to beat Dale Earnhardt.
That's not a view you want to see in your rearview mirror as you're 5 laps to go, Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt pulls up on that outside.
Drafting me, saving gas. He's just lined up catching me, but now he's going to draft me to save gas. I'm waving him. He's going, no, I'm not passing him. I keep waving him. No, I'm not passing him. So we're playing that cat and mouse game.
This looks like Earnhardt's game to play here. He has to shoot his shot. He's in the position. No question about it. We've seen failure.
And I'm watching the mirror, seeing what he's doing. He come out turn 4. I saw him slow up. He's out of gas. He's out of gas.
There's Earnhardt's crew standing up ready to come in. And Earnhardt is coming in. That's our way out of gas.
You're riding down for the finish. Checkered flag is out, and you are with Jeff Bodine. And he wins the 1986 Daytona 500.
Bodine is done. To win that race was phenomenal. I mean, it makes you a year.
Hendrick Motorsports could win the big races. But when it came to championships, any team that wanted to finish first had to first get past Earnhardt.
Here comes Earnhardt up on the inside.
Second championship in 1986. That same year, Rick defied conventional thinking and became a multi-car owner. People thought that adding a second car was crazy, but not as crazy as the driver. Tim Richmond wasn't quite like other racers.
He'd go to New York to get his hair cut, and everybody thought, boy, that is weird.
And came in there with his pressed blue jeans and sport jackets and his purse. He wanted to set a different image. He didn't want to be like all the rest of them.
There's rumors out there that he's a pretty free spirit, pretty wild sort of guy. Are you concerned about that?
Well, really, that's what the public really is looking for. You know, they want somebody that's human, not somebody putting up a front or acting. You know what I'm saying?
Wait a minute.
Now, would you care to make a comment on that?
Maybe no comment.
The girls liked him. And Tim liked girls. There was girls always lined up everywhere. Tim was always wide open.
He had that reputation. But I have to say, I talked to Tim when we started and said, look, in the sports, you got to keep your nose clean. And he did a good job.
In an unlikely move, the free spirit driver was paired with the old school crew chief, Harry Hyde.
But the only thing I want them to tell me is how the hell did Hot Pete have a bad position like 9 has got it now?
I don't think he's going to have to go without him. He's going to take him off the damn race.
He won't see me after the damn race. You tell him that.
Well, obviously, you can tell Harry Hyde has upset Jim Ledley. He's very, very confused.
He said what was on his mind. He would tell you right to your face, and I don't care how big you were. We had this huge guy that was working for us, and Harry fired him one day and then told him if, you know, he didn't like it, he'd whip him on top of that.
Rick is a master at putting people together. He seems to have an act of putting people together that has the qualities to do the job. Sometimes there might be some variation in their beliefs. That's what he's really done
with me.
They kept driving, never once.
They were a very good fit. Harry could control Tim. And once Harry figured out, I think, that what the potentials that Tim had, they just finally meshed.
He's the whole race track.
Oh, is he?
Looks like he's qualifying again.
Richmond down on the inside, sideways, still sideways.
He's been the story.
That's exactly right. He had probably the most phenomenal second half of the season that anybody has had in a long, long time.
Where's Harry at?
Well, Tim Richmond's streak hasn't run out. He's in Victory Lane here, hugging his crew chief now, Harry Hyde. It's become a tradition for them once they get in Victory Lane.
In just 3 years, Hendrick Motorsports had two winning drivers, and they'd grown into one of NASCAR's fastest rising and hardest working teams.
If there's a true sense of the word workaholic, I'm one. And I don't know how to relax and rest other than, go to the lake with my family. I do enjoy that a lot.
All my family memories are at the lake. I really can't remember much time as a family where we're really together having a great time that wasn't at the lake. My dad, we had a tiny little set of skis, and he'd pull with a rope every single morning to teach me how to ski on the edge of the bank and pull me off the bank. They did it just right because they spent money on moments.
Rick and Linda raised two children, daughter Lynn and younger son Ricky.
I loved them so much and appreciated every moment that I had with them and still do. I realized early in life, I don't take anyone I love for granted. Someone you love is not always going to be with you. So when I was 12 and my sister was 13, there was a lake across the street from our house. We were out swimming one day and I watched my sister drown. I learned to be appreciative of everyone that was in my life every single day. I never forgot how I felt. From that day forward, I believe, I don't think I ever said bye, whether it was on the phone or if I went somewhere, that I ever said goodbye to my family unless I said, I love you. Because I realized that I never know when that last time is that I'll see someone I love.
My brother and I were 4 years apart. He was very protective of me and my, who I was going to go out with. I remember one time at the lake, a guy pulled up. He had long hair and a boat and asked for me. And Ricky told him I wasn't there. He could leave, And I think he was 11 or 12 at the time. I mean, very young to have, almost too young to have that instinct to be that protective of a big sister. But we were best friends. We were together a lot. He lived with me in college. I remember doing some of his homework because he was at one college, I was at another, and he was traveling, going out, so much that sometimes, his sister had to finish his homework because he really needed to stay in school.
I think both of my children were unspoiled, very kind-hearted, very, very kind-hearted. I still wanted them to grow up to know how to treat other people. That has nothing to do with money. It shouldn't alter someone's lifestyle at all.
In high school, I was kind of the black sheep. Nobody knew what NASCAR was when I was in high school. I never went to a party. Every weekend that I could get away, I went and stayed with my grandparents. Pop would always have a Corvette off the used lot at Z Chevrolet, and he'd have it sitting there waiting for me. There's a special place in my heart for my grandfather.
Pop really is the father of this whole organization. And not just literally, very much so. His vision of an organization that could be competitive and at the same time very kind and good to people.
What do you think of the success that he's had in the sport?
He's got a good bunch of people. He loves people. And with everybody he's got working as hard as they are for him, I think he can do most anything he wants to. But it's the people that's working for him are the ones that do it.
We never forgot where we came from, and we never forgot how hard it was. And he said, I can't believe it. I still can't believe it that we're here doing this. I've really been blessed to see him enjoy himself so much after working so hard to give us what we wanted and needed growing up. He really kind of came into his own. He loved people, loved being around people.
I can tell you another time, when you were laying in the back seat asleep, and I was trying to pull the trailer under the, going through that carport to get around to the
what
back,
left,
and you said, he woke up, you wait. I said, man, you got a hammer. He said, what are you going to do with it? I knocked him in the damn head.
See, I had the best deal, so I didn't drive for Rick. I drove for Pop. Driving for Pop was better. When he came in, Pop had your excuse made up. Pop was just that kind of guy. I mean, I thought of Pop like my dad. If you go to work there, you're part of the family.
When you can have your family there doing something together like that, it's pretty special.
Now, Papa Joe loved going to Victory Lane. And in 1987, Tim Richmond was expected to take the team there many times. But something wasn't right with Tim.
And he came over to us and stuck his tongue out. He said, "Man, I don't know what's going on. I got these sores on my tongue and I'm taking this stuff and trying to get around. I don't know what's going on."
The doctor in California said, "You have to get him into a hospital immediately."
It was such a new disease anyway. It just caught me completely off guard.
"We're going to bring him back at a slow pace and make sure we don't overdo it."
When he went back in 87, he knew he wasn't going to make it through this, but he was going to race with everything he had. He was happy, but it was also sad because you knew he wasn't going to be with us anymore.
After 1987, Tim Richmond never raced again.
I don't know what made him a great driver. All I know is that when I see one, I know one. I've been watching him for 40 years, and he was the best thing that's maybe that will come along in our generation. I don't know.
It'd be interesting to see how many championships he could have won had he lived, because I think he would have been a champion.
Dale, let me be one of the first to congratulate you. You're the 1987 Winston Cup champion, and you finished second today, and that was a good shot for you.
Well, that ain't bad. The guys work hard all year long. It's a great year for us.
Earnhardt won another title. Hendrick Motorsports brought in a three-time champion, the outspoken Darrell Waltrip.
Rick said, "Well, I got a sponsor lined up that wants you to be the driver." They came up with this wild-looking orange-nosed, funky-looking paint job on the car, and I didn't really want to crazy about that at first. And the uniform, his underwear, it looked like a clown. And there's just a lot of things that were not coming down the way I had envisioned them. But nonetheless, it was a great opportunity and great sponsor, and so I kind of bought into all of it. That was the beginning of what was supposed to be the dream team.
The championship dream wasn't to be. Waltrip finished 7th in points in 1988. As the 89 season began, it seemed like he'd never win the one race that had always eluded him.
Waltrip is falling back a bit. Marlon taking second.
Yeah, you wonder if Waltrip might have some sort of a problem. He is definitely off the pace.
Every time there's a caution, I gotta come in the pits. We gotta jack up the front. We gotta put some weight. We gotta lower the track bar. We gotta check the toe. I mean, we're working on this thing like it's a practice session. Started to come around. 55 laps to go, and I mean, we pack that thing full of fuel. We might be able to make it to the end.
Are they going to be able to go that 55 laps on a tank of fuel?
So I started drafting and squeezing out the throttle and floating along behind people and letting somebody push me and somebody pull me, and sure enough, I mean, it gets down to the end of the day. Here I am, and I'm just floating along, you know, and everybody all of a sudden just starts peeling off. Can anybody make it? And I'm milking it, and I'm screaming on the radio, "I'm out of gas! I'm out of gas!" And nothing they can do. I don't know why I bothered to tell them. Just shake it, baby, shake it. I'm shaking the car around. Question of fuel. Can Walter hold out? I mean, this thing is it's running on the wing and a prayer.
I think he's running on a prayer.
He's got to be. I guarantee he's safe.
That's a big moment for everybody. It's not just about you, about putting something together and having it pay off and work that like it did and be in Victory Circle.
I remember being in Victory Lane and how special it was. And, you know, I don't think it's because of the race. I think it's because we work together and we create a bond.
I'm trying. I'm in the middle of this bear hug. Ken, car owner, Rick Hendrick, driver, Darrell Waltrip, wife, Stevie.
Oh, I won the Daytona 500. I won the Daytona 500.
Darrell, how long?
Wait. This is the Daytona 500.
Don't kill me in it! Thank God!
You know, we had been in racing, but we hadn't won a championship. Come close, but we hadn't won one. I thought you'd go to New York every year to see Earnhardt go up there and get the trophy, that we'd never be able to beat those guys.
Rick changed the plan. Youth over experience. Jeff Gordon had both. He was only 19, but he'd been racing since kindergarten. And the kid wasn't about to be bullied, not even by the Intimidator.
Jeff Gordon's coming, and he's going to drag Dale Earnhardt with him. Earnhardt wants the lead.
He almost led.
You're 19, you got your whole racing life in front of you. How would you like to be remembered?
Well, hopefully down the road, you know, that I can be a top Winston Cup driver. You know, I want to be up there with Dale Earnhardt, Kenny Schrader, Darrell Waltrip. You know, I would like to be one of them. That's my ultimate goal.
You know, I was just, you know, I felt like I was just a kid straight out of high school, which I almost was. And at that point, you know, I didn't know who to trust. I didn't know who was good, who wasn't good. Went to meet Rick Hendrick, and you spend a half hour, an hour talking with him, and nobody was as genuinely nice and seemed good-natured, good-hearted. How could you not do this deal? I mean, the potential that this team has.
Rick hired Jeff's friend, Ray Evernham, a crew chief who lacked experience but made up for it by outthinking and outworking the competition. Evernham's objective? Win championships. The car was 24. The crew was 1. They were warriors.
The whole thing about the Rainbow Warriors is we wanted to do something better every day, and I wanted people that were striving every day to be the best at something.
We were one of the first teams to actually start working out and doing individual specific drills, starting to work on the choreography of the stop itself. We realized that there was a lot to be gained if we really started to dissect it and really breaking down and videotaping and watch film review.
You guys all just do a really good job. You know, Jeff overshoots there just a little bit.
A little bit.
Well, you know, in terms of yards.
You know, a good coach, his biggest job is getting people to believe that they're better than they are.
And evidently you guys vividly imagined that you had awesome pit stops because you busted off some of the best and most consistent pit stops that you had last Sunday. I mean, that one pit stop looked like the Nutcracker Ballet. It looked like you were floating around there. Zoom, zoom, zoom. Tires on, tires off.
Most people can do and accomplish more than they think they can when they're motivated. And we had success, you know, fairly quickly.
In 1994, Earnhardt won his 7th and final title. 1995 belonged to Jeff Gordon.
The owner knows now that the championship is over, but Jeff Gordon is in fact going to be the 1995 Winston Cup champion.
He's ready for the champion
car. I got to congratulate Rick Hendricks and all his team. They did a great job. He's doing a championship, Rick is. He's been in a long time. I tested for him when he first started building cars. So.
Is it even more special, the fact that Earnhardt was second?
After 13 seasons in racing, Hendrick Motorsports finally arrived in New York as champions.
You asked me a couple of times when Tim Richmond was driving if Papa and I wanted to go to New York. And I said, no, when you win a championship, we'll go. So we did. And that was a proud moment of my life.
You know, when I was growing up with in Virginia on a farm with my dad building cars, and my mother and my father were my heroes. She taught me how to borrow money, which I do a good job at today. And my dad taught me how to build cars and race cars, and I did that since I was 14. And you know, it was just all these years that we waited for something like this to happen. But that little gentleman right there this year, you know, he's been called the kid. But tonight I want to thank the champion for giving me my first championship. Thank you, Jeff.
Jeff Gordon was the new face of NASCAR. It was a lot for a 24-year-old to handle.
It was just a little overwhelming for me. You know, I had everybody tell me how great I was. I started believing I was great. I just thought that I didn't owe anybody anything. I just wanted to go hide. I just thought that when I left that racetrack, that was my personal time. This is my personal space. It was catching me off guard, and I didn't know how to handle it. And so I kind of was trying to hide a little bit by, I was married at this time, and we just sort of didn't do anything, didn't go anywhere, stayed in our house. And it really took till 1999 before I started going, you know what, I'm not bigger than this sport. I'm not bigger than this team. I'm somebody that's been very fortunate, very blessed, need to be thankful for everything that I have. And so it took me a while to get back to that.
I was a fan of his. I mean, it's like, man, this kid's awesome here.
In the mid-90s, the team added Terry Labonte, a former champion who discovered an uncommon atmosphere at Hendrick Motorsports.
One of the guys that told me before I ever went to work there, they said, as corny as this can sound, he said, this is like one happy family. And I said, really? And they said, yeah, really. And I was like, I'd driven for some different teams. It wasn't ever a happy family. Any other teams I really had driven for. And it was that way down here. I said, I couldn't believe it.
Here comes the Ushman.
Terry Labonte is like a robot. When he starts running the particular racetrack, he gets into a mode and he does not make many mistakes.
It'll be Terry Labonte or Jeff Gordon in victory lane. They're down the backstretch. Still nose to tail, but Terry holding off the challenge of the defending NASCAR Winston Cup champion.
Thank you, Rick Hendrick. All the guys on the Kellogg's team, all our sponsors, Quaker State, GMAC, Kellogg's, all the guys that just hung in there. It's just a great day.
Thank you all very much, and it's a pleasure to be here. I will not promise you that I'll be the best Winston Cup champion that we've ever had, but I will promise you I'll do the best job I can representing the sport I love so much. Thank you all.
With back-to-back titles, Hendrick Motorsports was the best team in all of NASCAR. But that night in New York, nobody knew the hard times that were just ahead.
Everything's just going so good, everything's rolling along, and then pow, out of nowhere, this news comes.
They called me from the doctor's office and said, you need to come in for another test, your white count's a little high. Well, I didn't know what white count meant. I said, what's the worst case? What could it be? And he said, well, the worst case, it could be leukemia. And so, sure enough, when I went back, he confirmed that I had leukemia.
And he said it could be 6 months. It's pretty aggressive, or it could be up to 5 years. I've never known him to live longer than five. He said, but the average is probably two. Anybody but him, anybody, you can't stop him. And to see him slow down so much and be so sick.
I've been to some children's hospitals and visited kids before at a young age. If you catch it early enough and get it into remission, but at an older individual, it could be life-threatening.
He took chemo and he took interferon every single day. And one by itself would put someone under and make it difficult to get out of bed. And he took both every day.
I said, I can't do this anymore. And it was Linda and my daughter, Lynn, that said, hey, you gotta keep fighting.
He fought hard. And he was so terribly sick 24 hours a day, not just during the day, but, he was a fighter.
While Rick was fighting for his life, he also faced a struggle involving his auto dealerships.
Well, the enthusiasm of this NASCAR Winston Cup banquet was kind of dampened because of the indictment handed down against Rick Hendrick earlier. Those indictments, of course, in connection with an alleged scheme involving Rick Hendrick's Honda dealerships.
For his character to get beat up like that in the public was really, really hard for him. I just couldn't believe all the things that were happening. Why were they happening to Rick? This is the greatest guy that I know. There's just nothing that I could say about him bad. And why is this happening to such a great person?
When the 97 season started in Daytona, Rick wasn't there. but his team was. Unable to attend the banquet in New York.
Rick, what an inspiration you are. This has been the most difficult year of our lives. Tonight, we are here to congratulate you, not only as a great car owner, but as a greater person. Sweetheart, you're always the winner, and I'm proud to be your wife. At this time, I'd like to ask Rick's dad, Papa Joe Hendrick, to please come forward and receive the 1997 NASCAR Winston Cup Championship Car Owner's Trophy for his son, Rick Hendrick.
That was a proud day for me. I was, I'll always remember that one as being probably the most special.
Rick found strength in family. He turned to his younger brother, John, to run the team while he was gone.
I know the first couple times Rick talked to me about coming over to help him do this when he got sick, it took three or four times for me to understand and realize he was really serious about it. And that first couple times, I said, yeah, right, you want me to come to motorsports.
John always looked up to you. And if he wanted anything, he didn't come to me and Pop. It was my brother. It was always my brother.
Dad was more the dreamer, the innovator, the get the deal done. My uncle was very good at maintaining some things and keeping things in balance.
John was the guy that held it all together, you know, while Rick was sick and going through these other problems. I think if John wouldn't come in, I'm afraid you'd have seen a power struggle there, you know, two or three different people trying to, you know, get their little herd of people behind them to maybe gain power or control or something, but there never was an issue with John there.
It's been a challenging role for me, but it's been my way of repaying him for some of the things he's done in my life. He's meant so much in my life to me and helped me so much in my management skills and how to treat people, and I'll never forget that. It was my opportunity to repay him a little bit.
New to racing, John leaned heavily on Randy Dorton, one of Hendrick Motorsports' first employees.
Here's the man who puts the muscle in the machines. Randy, good to see you. Randy Dorton, who you're in charge of the entire Hendrick Motor program, right?
That's right. Yeah, head of all the engine program.
He was really a pillar of the company. He helped us grow it. He was a perfectionist. He liked to do it right.
You know, whenever something went wrong or whenever you needed an answer for something, he was the guy you called. It didn't matter what it was. He was a bigger part of Hendrick Motorsports than just the engines. He crew chiefed for me for two races, Charlotte, and the next weekend we went to Talladega. And that was his second weekend as a crew chief. And we won the race. And I put my arm around him at victory lane there, and I said, how about that? The second time I was a crew chief and you won the race, I said, you don't even know the difference between caster and camber, how you set the front end on a car. I said, but we had the best engineer.
What is your opinion of a restrictor plate racing?
Well, I really want to tell you the truth. Yeah, I know it.
Along with new Vice President Jeff Turner, John and Randy helped turn 1998 into a landmark season. Jeff Gordon won 13 races and his third title, making Hendrick Motorsports the first team ever to win the championship 4 years in a row.
John, how much does it mean to you to be representing not only your brother, your family, but the whole Hendrick Motorsports organization here as champions?
What an incredible year it's been. It's been a learning experience of a lifetime. It's certainly a year that I will never forget.
We've missed you, Rick. We can't wait to take you to victory lane next year.
At Charlotte in 1999, Rick returned to the track for the first time in over 2 years.
Here's Gordon, flying the body for the lead on the back straightaway. Gordon low, the body high, into turn three. Side by side, they start off turn four. Gordon gets a little edge, they start off the corner. Squeezes up in front of body to body and shuts off the right lane. Jeff Gordon wins in Charlotte, moving in the Rainbow Warrior team.
In 2001, Hendrick Motorsports reached an epic milestone.
One lap to go! And they're side by side! It's going inside! Rod with a car length advantage!
Get up and clear! You gotta get in front of him! You can't let him come back on the outside! Oh, clear!
Rod just stuck it in too deep at the bottom of turn one. Lost the momentum. Gordon got the lead. Rod's coming back! Gordon to the line! And Gordon to win!
I was able to come and watch the 100th win ceremony for Rick, and I just thought, man, if I could win a race and be on that list as one of the guys that's won a race for Mr. Hendrick, my life would be complete.
Jimmy Johnson grew up on dirt bikes and off-road racing. He also grew up with another dream.
Yeah, Jimmy, ever tell you he had a DuPont 24 car on his headboard in his bedroom, you know, and that embarrasses the heck out of him. But he said, yeah, it's true, you know. So, I mean, he kind of looked up to me before he ever met me, you know, just because of what I'd accomplished. Well, he hasn't been with me all those times I was talking about earlier in the 90s when I may have been an asshole. Spent 15 minutes with him and was really impressed. The fact that he had the guts to come up to me and ask me for my time and my advice. And then in the race, five to go.
You look back on the Jimmy Johnson machine.
You know, my car's better than his, and I'm going to show this kid. And I could catch him.
See, Jeff Gordon, last time by, was faster than Jimmy Johnson.
I couldn't pass him anyway. And so I was impressed. And so I think it was the next day, you know, I called Rick, and he said, I'm on board. Are you on board? If you're on board, I'm on board. You know, sort of that type of deal. Once you become competitors on the track, it can change the dynamic of your friendship. And it probably has in some ways, but 10, 20 years from now, I think me and Jimmy are still going to be really good friends.
Jimmy Johnson came into NASCAR when the sport was changing. 2001 had started with the tragic loss of Jeff Gordon's greatest competitor and NASCAR's legendary intimidator. The season ended with Gordon's fourth championship. Only Richard Petty and Dale Earnhardt had won more. Jeff was no longer the kid. With age came wisdom, and with wisdom came humility.
Johnny, get in here, bud. Get in here, man.
Oh, my goodness.
Don't cover your face up, though. There you go.
She tell me, don't overreact and give me a champagne bottle and I drown.
No, I'm glad
I think I got 10 more bottles
you can shake all of.
We definitely built a great relationship. But in my opinion, it really grew to a whole nother level when I went through my divorce. Because, you know, he was really one of the first, I think he was the first person that I really went to because I trusted in him. And in a way, I did look to him as like a second dad.
He said, well, I need to talk to you. And I thought, oh, man, what is this about? And he was sweating, his shirt was wet all up under his arms. And I thought, he's going to tell me he wants to leave or go do something different. And then he told me he was having some problems at home, and that's when I gave him the best advice I could, which he didn't follow.
he helped me get a lawyer. that was one of the things he helped me with. But Rick has some awesome advice. The three things that he told me to make sure I did during that process.
I told him, I said, you don't hit her, you don't leave home, and you don't get caught with your britches down. He didn't hit her, but it did the other two, you know, so. We did have an opportunity to really bond during that period.
Shortly after that, I lived with him and Linda in their spare bedroom.
It was so strange to see him walk through the house with a t-shirt and a pair of jeans on and say, I'm going to the mall for a few minutes. Like, okay, son, see you when you come back, you know.
That was when I really felt like I was another son to them because of how they took me in and treated me and supported me.
I love Jeff. Rick loves Jeff. We both do. We feel like that he's a child of ours.
That's right, man.
He was very young when we first met him, and he started driving for us. It was easy for us to have a parental feeling about him, and that's never left, and it never will.
Be careful, man. Don't go in.
When he left our home, he moved into our son's home and lived with him for a while. So again, that was a natural fit because we all felt like we were one big family.
So we became roommates. It was me and him and a couple of his buddies, and I became really close with Ricky. Shoot, I was just so impressed with what a great kid that he was.
Ricky used to write little stories and when he was in the second grade that racing ran through his veins like water in a brook.
Anything that had a motor on it, I wanted to get on it and figure out how to ride it or how to make it go fast. And, you know, my dad just let me start racing go-karts. It kind of evolved, you know. At first it was just fun and I really didn't take it too serious. And then I started enjoying it. I started kind of growing up into the competitive side of things.
Your first win, you earned it the hard way.
Yeah. Did you miss what sent me out the good car last Tuesday night? It sent me out the good car this Tuesday night. I just kept it out front, you know. It was a good, clean race, you know. First win.
Me and Ricky ran against each other in a Legends race once, I remember, and Ricky beat me. I finished right behind him. I saw a lot of similarities in Ricky growing up with the wealth and the lifestyle and the opportunities in front of him, and saw a lot of similarities there with my life. I like to get around him and watch how he handled things and see what decisions he made. We kind of both had a lot in common as far as coming up under our father's shadow. And I think Ricky understood following his father. He was still always going to have those comparisons. We both appreciated the challenge in each other's lives. And, you know, we would just daydream about, you know, man, you need to start a team. I'd drive for you.
Ricky came in one day at dinner, and he said, I'll tell you, Earnhardt's going to drive for me one day. And I said, right, okay.
Ricky entered the NASCAR Truck Series in 2001, where he was teamed with three-time Hendrick Motorsports champion Jack Sprague.
He came in, and I thought, you know, what good is going to come of this? Because I'm the teacher, so that's going to distract our team. You know, he can't help me. Boss's kid, rich kid, you know how that goes a lot of time in business. You know, he's parking him there to get him out of his hair. Whoever has to deal with him's gonna be miserable. It wasn't it, man. I mean, he was fun, he was a good dude, he was very caring. It was way different than I ever thought that it was gonna come out, as far as he didn't act like, you know, rich kid at all. My daughter was 4 or 5 years old. He'd come over and sit down outside with her, and he'd color with her, and And she just thought that was the coolest thing. I mean, here's this adult kid who, you know, basically a kid, 18, 19-year-old kid, that certainly has better things to do than sit down with a 4-year-old and color. But he did it, and I was so proud and happy of what we were able to help Ricky do.
Muscles.
The power stroke diesel certainly is, but Ricky's hanging in there awfully well on the outside. See, Ted wiggle a little bit coming off from turn two. That allowed Ricky to pull back ahead. Now bring it down to the inside, Ricky.
Ricky is 21 years, 3 months, and 5 days old. If he can hold on, he will become the youngest driver ever to win the NASCAR Fastmark Truck Series competition. Ricky Henry and a GMAC Chevrolet win. Here comes the
you.
It is. I tell you, I can't say enough for my father and my mother. You know, if it wasn't for Hendrick Motorsports, we wouldn't be here. Dedicate this to my grandfather. He's in the hospital, and my guys did a great job.
I was just so proud of him, and then had all these flashbacks of this little guy growing up. Here he was, accomplishing something that he wanted so bad.
Well, let's get your mom and dad in here. I know they want to celebrate with you, and they're right here. You're going to get a hug from dad. Rick, got to be proud of this young guy.
Yeah, I really am.
It's okay. I know. I know what you're feeling. That's a very emotional dad and a proud father, too.
That was the most emotional race I've ever had, and what a very good time in our lives.
Just don't know what might be fighting. You could be anything, girl.
Trouble, one. One car, two cars, hard in the wall. In turn one. Ricky Hendrick is one of them.
Ricky was injured, and his driving career was over. As his replacement, he took a chance on a 19-year-old unknown.
Rick didn't really know who I was or never really saw me or watched me that much. And, you know, Ricky wanted to hire me, so it was kind of a little bit of an internal struggle.
You know, it took a little while of me convincing him and him finally saying, look, you know, this is your team. You know, you brought all these guys along. And if this is what you want to do, then I support you 100%.
19-year-old Brian Vickers driving for Rick Hendrick is going to take the checkered flag and become a first-time NASCAR Busch Series winner. Rick, right here, come here. Ricky, he's supporting me. The whole deal, Ricky. Yep. Come here, Ricky.
All right.
He supported me. This whole Ricky picked me to drive this car, and it was an awesome opportunity. I thank him, the world of him.
I brought something to the table here a little bit with Brian, you know, and I feel like I've been a help. I haven't just been the son that's getting handed over something.
His dad used to get on to him about wearing our hat backwards. So instead of turning the hat around, he just moved the sponsors. He just put the sponsor on the back and then put the number on the front. You know, he'd make all new hats with the sponsors on the back so it was on the front when you turned it around. He left Rick with nowhere to go. You know, his excuse for not wearing the hat backwards was sponsors. Well, okay, problem solved. Now what? Next.
And the 2003 NASCAR Busch Series champion is Brian Vickers driving for Hendrick Motorsports.
Man, I'll tell you, I don't even know if this is Ricky's deal, and I'm down here.
To see him at such a young age go out on his own and accomplish what he did, you feel so honored to be a parent of someone that you admire so much.
You know, I got my dad, thank you so much, him, Pop, and my mom for believing in me and letting me do and what I wanted to do and bring Brian along. So thank you so much, and see you next year.
Yes!
I was happy because I felt like he was going to make a step toward the ultimate deal, and that's to run motorsports one day.
You know, I look at my position here in motorsports and think that, hey, maybe one day that, you know, I'll have his position, you know, and I'll have to be, you know, the boss. I'm still learning day to day. The only thing I want to do is help the organization be successful.
You know, I called Ricky one day and we were talking, and I said, how would you like to go to Hawaii? And he said, Mom, I think it'd be great. The first night in Hawaii, a plane crashed into a mountain next to our hotel. And the next morning, my son came by my room and knocked on the door to go to breakfast. And he said, Mom, how in the world does a plane crash into a mountain? And I said, Son, sometimes things happen in life
that we can't explain and that we don't understand. I can't tell you. And he said, well, Mom, I want you to know one thing. He said, I believe that when it's your time, it's your time. And when it's my time, I'm ready. And I told him how much I loved him and how proud I was of him. You know, that was the end of the conversation, and we ate breakfast and enjoyed the entire week. The day we came back, the next morning, is when, you know, he got on the plane that crashed.
My phone rang, it was Sunday morning, it was Ricky. I'm like, boy, what in the world are you doing? Because he never called me on Sunday. He's like, well, just waiting to get on the plane. I'm like, you ain't Martinsville yet? No. Weather's bad, and we were going to helicopter, and they said no.
He was running late. He was spotting for me at the time. And he was like, you know, whatever, weather, sorry, I'm going to be a few minutes late. So we had a temporary spot until we got there. And we were talking about, you know, kick-ass party we were going to throw that night after the race for my 21st birthday. And the race went on, and, you know, Ricky never came on.
We were running the race, and people knew. We didn't know. As drivers, we didn't know. And Jimmy won the race.
Jimmy Johnson picks up his sixth win of 2004.
Chad cues up the radio and, like, man, they don't want you to go to they don't want you to do any burnouts or go to victory lane. Come straight to pit road. And they're going to put officials around the cars. And when I climbed out of the car, I could see my publicist, and her eyes were swollen. And I knew something bad at that point had happened.
When I pulled around the front stretch and all 400 cars were sitting there, I just had a feeling in the pit of my stomach that something was wrong. And they took us to the trailer, and that was it.
I'm with Jim Hunter, who's NASCAR's Vice President of Corporate Communications. And Jim, you have some very sad news.
Yes, we've been made aware the FAA reported they lost contact with a Hendrick Motorsports airplane inbound for Martinsville.
We were waiting to find the plane, and Dad made us feel like they were going to find it and everything was going to be okay. And I really felt a calming from him saying that. I really felt like we were going to find something and something was going to be okay. And got the word, it was done. They found the plane and there was no survivors.
10 people were on the plane. Joe Jackson, an executive with team-sponsored DuPont. John Hendrick and his twin daughters, Kimberly and Jennifer. Randy Dorton. Ricky Hendrick. Pilots Richard Tracy and Elizabeth Morrison. Passenger Scott Lathram. Hendrick Motorsports General Manager Jeff Turner.
It was just my dad and I in the foyer. We were passing. We weren't standing there together, but we were passing when I heard the news, and I looked at him and I said, we're not a family anymore. And just lost it. And he said, yes, we are. Yes, we are.
You can't prepare for anything like that. You just can't prepare for the shock and the hurt and the grief and, you know, that you go through.
It's not natural for a child you carry in your body, you know, a life, and that you spend 24 hours a day with, and then they leave you. When am I going to stop hurting so much? I mean, when is this severe pain of losing him going to go away? I thought you're supposed to go before your children.
Lynn and her brother, just she and Ricky were closer than any two people I've ever met.
You know, he treated me like he knew that I needed him, you know?
Lynn's dad asked her to give the eulogy at the memorial service in front of thousands of people. Incredibly difficult circumstances.
And it was my one chance to let people know how wonderful he was and how wonderful my uncle was and my cousins were. I have some things I want to say. I would like to thank you all for being here today to show your respects from Uncle John, cousins Jennifer and Kimberly, and my brother Ricky. I have so many fond memories of 24 years growing up with him. I will try my hardest to remember the sweet sound of his voice, his unforgettable laugh, his calming temperament, and the absolute greatest smile in the world. I can speak on behalf of all those who knew and loved John, that we'll miss his strength of leadership and compassion to everyone. In speaking for the family today, I'm actually standing in for him. This was his place. Stories I've heard a lot about Uncle John was his love and affinity to be close to his girls. He was crazy about his daughters. For me, I rarely thought of Jennifer and Kimberly as separate. They're identical angels. Somehow, Mom and Dad, we will make it through this together. Dad, you dedicated a song to me not too long ago after Pop's death. My favorite part says, "Open up your soul. Let the moment hold you. Don't push it away. Don't you know you belong in the sun, and your day will come." I dedicate this right back to you and Mom. I can't remember hurting much worse, but when I look back, I draw so much strength on those memories. We would go to the gravesite, and it was a rock church. My grandfather rebuilt that church after it burnt down would literally go collect the rocks off the river and build this church back up. That's where he was buried, and that's where my cousins and my uncle are buried. It's this little graveyard that's really just our family. My dad and I would go right to his gravesite, and we'd hold hands and we'd pray. And we'd listen to that song. It's strange how some of the hardest times in your life, when you think back, can be the most comforting. Because those are the times that you draw strength, and those are the times that you really pray and you really mean it.
I had to kind of shake myself and say, Linda, there's still people here that you love, that you need. You can't let that rob you of the ones that you still do love.
Mr. Hendrick, when he came back here, I don't really know how he found the strength to come back here. And, within a couple of days, he came back and met with all of us in our meeting room, the whole company. And, he was strong enough to stand up there and motivate us.
Didn't know if your emotions would let you walk in the room and say something. And Jeff Gordon was sitting right on the front row. And actually, once I was in that room with the people, I knew that that was something I needed to do.
He just said that this is where he wants to be, that these are the people that he cares about, and this is what keeps him going. And
had this message of solidarity and strength and perseverance and hope. It was very special.
The emotion of all of the folks and all the support gave us the strength to go ahead and do it and go on.
The rest of the company was looking for guidance as to what now. And all I knew, the answer to what now was that we have to go to Atlanta and we race. That's what we do.
Our panel has asked for this time to visit with you to share their remembrances and their thoughts. This team's going to be stronger than it's ever been, and we've got great people, and I don't think I've ever seen anything that's going to pull this team together any closer than it can get.
I can't think of anything that could drive us harder and stronger than this loss.
And amazing people do amazing things in times like this, and I think that's what's going to stick out in my mind the most.
Open up your soul.
Come on, bring it home. Bring it home.
they put their heart in it, and it was really neat.
This is unbelievable. I just talked to Rick on the phone. He said, put my helmet on backwards for little Ricky. So there it is for little Ricky, Randy Dorton, Joe Jackson, Liz and Dick, Jeff Turner. I had 10 angels riding on this race car.
Really, I think, a turning point in some ways for the whole place. We could carry on.
We'll never forget those people, and they made a tremendous contribution. They made the biggest contribution in life you could make, and has given it their lives, you know, to something they loved. And what would they want you to do?
Weeks later, Jimmy Johnson won again, his fourth victory in five races. Heading into the season finale, the championship was within reach for Hendrick Motorsports. Rick returned to the track to be with his team.
To honor all of those people on that plane, I'm more committed to this sport than I've ever been. And together, we're going to be a strong competitor and a good citizen of this sport.
The 48 and the 24 fought together. But at race's end, they had fallen just 8 and 16 points short of the championship. Hendrick Motorsports carried on, driven not just to race, but to win. A championship to honor those who were lost. In 2006, Jimmy Johnson's time had come.
We can do this. We just had the worst situation possible. This team's stronger, tighter unit. Now let's go win that championship.
Jimmy Johnson gonna win the 48 Daytona 500.
Occasion.
Thank you, Rick Hendrick, for having the desire to keep this place going. I can remember Randy giving me advice one time on the death of my grandmother. His interpretation of life after death. He told me that when people leave your life unexpectedly, don't be sad. Celebrate. Celebrate what they were. Celebrate what they meant to you. Remember your last image of me. Remember the good things. Never forget that.
The week following the accident, Ricky's fiancée, Emily, brought the family news of a miracle.
I think it was the day after the service. Emily came with her mom to see us and said, I got something to tell you. I'm pregnant. And she said, we don't know how you guys feel about it. And I said, well, we're ecstatic. You know, we just can't tell you how happy we are. She looks like him. She has the same little mannerisms. And it just reminds us so much of him when he was young. That's a piece of him that we get to keep.
Every time I look at her, you know, you see a little bit of her daddy, and you just can't ever forget the ways he used to look at you and talk to you because you see it in her face.
In 2008, Ricky's prediction came true. 25 years after Dale Earnhardt won Rick's first race, his son, Dale Jr., joined Hendrick Motorsports.
He lost his father, I lost my son, and we were, you know, we both know the pain in the same way.
I ain't trying to replace anything that he's lost in life, and he's not doing the same for me. We're just good buddies and just enjoy being around each other, and we're lucky, I guess, to be able to work together. He's like, I hope you love me as much as I love you. It's just unique to have people like that in your life try to help you out, and pretty cool.
1 year after Junior, veteran Mark Martin joined the Hendrick family.
Mark Martin takes the win! Jeff Gordon finishes in second!
I can't believe that. Mark, you didn't win. You crushed a baby. You crushed a baby.
Love you guys, man. We love you.
The whole group at Hendrick Motorsports has been inspired to want to succeed for Mr. Hendrick. Comes from his approach to the way he treats people, involves the family.
First thing I want you to always be like you've always been. In your 60 years, Rick, love your family like you do and respect other people, and I don't know of anybody that does that any better than you do.
I'm very proud of my dad. I mean, I just can't believe he is my dad.
I don't think that I've ever been around somebody who is more widely regarded than Rick.
And I've never, ever heard anybody say anything about him, which is amazing.
He seems to thrive on being able to help people. That seems to be his medication.
I love the guy, you know, and he means the world to me. He's been such a huge influence in my life. He's been there for me during the good and the bad times. You know, he's somebody that I know I could turn to anytime, and he'd be there for me. That goes beyond friends. You know, and there's very few people out there that I would consider in that category, and I think it's my mom, my dad, and him.
I think the thing I'm going to cherish when it's all over are the people I've got to be really close to and the things that we've gone through together.
In 2009, Rick returned to Martinsville Speedway for the 25th anniversary of his first Cup win.
This is our 25th anniversary now. You're not going to let me down, are you?
No, sir. We're just trying to get a new movie out of it.
Martinsville Speedway, green flag. Boy, Denny Hamlin, he's going to dive to the inside. He stayed right on the rear bumper of Johnson on the restart. He jumped on it the minute the green flag was displayed. He knew he was going to get behind. He had to do it right there and then.
Oh, I don't think this little battle will end right here, though.
Martinsville on the 25th anniversary of Hendrick Motorsports' first win.
Thank you. I want that one pretty bad.
I didn't do anything to get that one for you.
Thank you, buddy. I appreciate that. Another compliment.
Thank you. I started it. You're finishing it. Well, I was thinking, I got to win the stamp, no matter what it takes.
Hey, man.
no better way to celebrate 25 years than to be able to win a race.
After 25 years, Rick Hendrick is at home in Victory Lane. Surrounded by memories. Memories of victory and of loss. Memories of a team. A team that became a family.
When people are down and when people are hurting, that's when we become that family.
I think that the people here really look towards each other for strength like you can in a family. Together, we're always going to have that strength that's pulled us through adversity.
Through the tragedy, through Dev's cancer, through the success, with racing, with everything. You know, we've all done it together.
I hope that we always have that special relationship that all of us have over there, that we are a big family. We care about each other and we're going to be together.
Jeff, sorry about that. You wrecked my race car, Tim.
I know. I'm sorry.
Y'all look better on the side or a head on.
Turn around.
I'll show my ass quick enough.
Rick Hendrick got put on the same level as my father, Al Richmond. But he's the only one on that level.
What a compliment. I'm a really true sports legend.
You know what I think of you?
No.
It's just repetition, basically. You do something so many times, it's just like when you get out of bed in the morning.
Sir, congratulations. Here is John Hendrick. John Hendrick comes in to give a big cut, and we contested it. It was pretty good. We thought we'd be...
Oh my goodness.